Need a simple, practical intro to CanFD? In this guide, we introduce CanFD, CAN with flexible data rate. CanFD frames overhead and efficiency, example applications, and logging use cases. Note, CanFD can seem complex, so in this tutorial, we'll try to keep things simple and provide visual illustrations. The CAN protocol has been around since 1986, and it's popular. Practically any machine that moves utilizes CAN today, whether it's cars, trucks, boats, planes, or robots. But with the rise of modern technology, the classical CAN protocol is pressured. First of all, a rise in vehicle functionality is driving an explosion in data. As such, networks are increasingly limited by the 1 megabit per second bandwidth. To cope, OEMs are currently forced to create complex and costly workarounds. Specifically, classical CAN struggles with substantial overhead, more than 50%, as each CAN data frame can only contain 8 data bytes. Further, the network speed is limited to 1 megabit per second, restricting the implementation of data-producing features. CAN-FD resolves these issues, making it future-proof. So, what is CAN-FD? The CAN-FD protocol was pre-developed by Bosch with industry experts and released in 2012. It was improved through standardization and is now in ISO 11898-1:2015. CAN-FD offers 4 major benefits. Number 1, increased length. CAN-FD supports up to 64 data bytes per data frame versus 8 data bytes for classical CAN. This reduces the protocol overhead and leads to an improved protocol efficiency. Number 2, increased speed. CAN-FD supports dual bit rates. The normal arbitration bit rate, limited to 1 megabit per second, as in classical CAN, and the data bit rate, which depends on the network topology or transceivers. In practice, data bit rates up to 5 megabits per second are achieved. Number 3, better reliability. CAN-FD uses an improved cyclic redundancy check, CRC, and the protected stuff bit counter, which lower the risk of undetected errors. This is, an example, vital in safety, critical applications like vehicles and industrial automation. Number 4, smooth transition. CAN-FD and classical CAN, only ECUs, can be mixed under certain conditions. This allows for a gradual introduction of CAN-FD nodes, greatly reducing costs and complexity for OEMs. In practice, CAN-FD can improve network bandwidth by a factor of 3 to 8 versus classical CAN, thus creating a simple solution to the rise in data. Next, let's take a look at how CAN-FD works. So, CAN-FD seems pretty simple. Speed up the data transmission and pack more data into each message, right? In practice, however, it's not that straightforward. Let us consider 2 critical features of classical CAN that we wish to maintain with CAN-FD. Number 1, avoid critical message delays. So, why not simply pack classical CAN frames with 64 bytes of data? Doing so would reduce overhead and simplify message interpretation. However, if the bitrate is unchanged, this would block the CAN bus for longer, potentially delaying mission-critical higher-priority data frames. Number 2, maintain practical CAN wire lengths. In other words, more speed is needed to send more data per message. But why not then speed up the entire CAN message, rather than just the data phase? This is due to arbitration. If 2 or more nodes transmit data simultaneously, arbitration determines which node takes priority. The winner continues sending without delay, while the other nodes back off during the data transmission. During arbitration, a bit time provides sufficient delay between each bit to allow every node on the network to react. To be certain that every node is reached within the bit time, a CAN network running at 1 megabit per second needs to have a maximum length of 40 meters, in practice, 25 meters. Speeding up the arbitration process would reduce maximum length to unsuitable levels. On the other hand, after arbitration, there's an empty highway, enabling high speed during the data transmission when there is just one node driving the bus lines. Before the ACK slot, when multiple nodes acknowledge the correct reception of the data frame, the speed needs to be reduced to the nominal bitrate. To summarize, CANFD would need to find a way to only increase the speed during the data transmission. Let's look at the solution, aka the CANFD frame. The CANFD protocol introduces an adjusted CAN data frame to enable the extra data bytes and flexible bit rates. In this overview, we compare an 11-bit classical CAN frame versus an 11-bit CANFD frame. Note that 29-bit CANFD identifiers are also supported. Let's look at each of the fields, RTR versus RRS. The remote transmission request, RTR, is used in classical CAN to identify data frames and corresponding remote frames. In CANFD, remote frames are not supported at all. The remote request substitution, RRS, is always dominant, 0. R0 versus FDF. In classical CAN, R0 is reserved and dominant, 0. In CANFD, it's named FDF and recessive, 1. After the R0 or FDF bit, the CANFD protocol adds 3 new bits. Note that nodes that are not CANFD capable produce an error frame after the FDF bit, RES. This new reserved bit plays the same role as R0. In other words, it may in the future be set to recessive 1 to denote a new protocol, BRS. The bitrate switch, BRS, can be dominant, 0, meaning that the CANFD data frame is sent at the arbitration rate, in other words, to a max 1 megabit per second. Setting it to recessive, 1, means that the remaining part of the data frame is sent at a higher bitrate, up to 5 megabits per second. ESI. The error status indicator, ESI bit, is by default dominant, 0. In other words, error active. If the transmitter becomes error passive, it'll be recessive, 1, to indicate it is in error passive mode. DLC. Like in classical CAN, the CANFD DLC is 4 bits and denotes the number of data bytes in the frame. The above table shows how the two protocols use the DLC consistently up to 8 data bytes. To maintain a 4-bit DLC, CANFD uses the remaining 7 values from 9 to 15 to denote the number of data bytes used, 12, 16, 20, 24, 32, 48, 64. SBC. The stuff bit count, SBC, precedes the CRC and consists of 3 gray-coded bits and a parity bit. The following fixed stuff bit can be regarded as a second parity bit. The SBC is added to improve communication reliability. CRC. The cyclic redundancy check, CRC, is 15-bit in the classical CAN, while in CANFD, it's 17 bits for up to 16 data bytes, or 21 bits for 20 to 64 data bytes. In classical CAN, there can be 0 to 3 stuff bits in the CRC, while in CANFD, there are always 4 fixed stuff bits to improve communication reliability. ACK. The data phase, aka payload of the CANFD data frame, stops at the ACK bit, which also marks the end of the potentially increased bitrate. As evident, the added functionality of CANFD adds a lot of extra bits versus classical CAN. So how can this lead to less overhead? The answer is that it doesn't. See, for example, this visualization of classical CAN versus CANFD for 3 data bytes. In fact, the efficiency of CANFD does not exceed classical CAN until crossing 8 data bytes. However, as we move towards 64 data bytes, the efficiency can go from the 50% that we have in classical CAN up towards 90%. As mentioned, sending 64 data bytes at regular speed would block the CAN bus, reducing the real-time performance. To solve this, bitrate switching can be enabled to allow the payload to be sent at a higher rate versus the arbitration rate, in example, 5 megabits per second versus 1 megabit per second. This is visually evident if we look at the effect of using bitrate switching for the 3 data byte and 64 data byte scenarios. Note that the higher speed applies to the data frame section starting in the BRS bit and ending in the CRC delimiter. Note also that most vehicles today use 0.25 to 0.5 megabits per second, meaning that with 5 megabits per second, the CAN-FD protocol would increase the speed of the payload transmission by a factor of 10. For more on this, see the full CAN-FD intro article, where you'll also find our CAN-FD calculator. This lets you play around with various variables to illustrate the efficiency and average bit rates of CAN-FD versus classical CAN. So, we've illustrated why CAN-FD is important and how it works. Next, let's look at 6 examples of CAN-FD applications that rely on the faster data rates. Number 1, electric vehicles. EVs and hybrids use new powertrain concepts that require far higher bit rates. Added complexity comes from new control units related to DC, DC inverter, battery, charger, range extender, etc. By 2025, it is expected that the required bitrate exceeds CAN, and with the explosive rise in EVs, this may be the spearhead of the CAN-FD rollout. Number 2, ECU flashing. Vehicle software is becoming increasingly complex. As such, performing ECU updates via, in example, the OBD2 port can take hours today. With CAN-FD, such processes can be made 4 times faster. This use case has been one of the original drivers behind the demand for CAN-FD by automotive OEMs. Number 3, robotics. Several applications rely on time-synced behavior, in example, robot arms with multiple axles. Such devices can use CAN open and require multiple CAN frames, PDOs, to be sent by each controller time-synced without interruption from higher priority frames. By shifting to CAN-FD, the data can be sent in a single frame for efficiency. Number 4, ADAS and safe driving. Increasingly, advanced driver assistance systems, ADAS, are being introduced in passenger cars and commercial vehicles. This pressures the busload of classical CAN, yet ADAS is key to improving safety. Here, CAN-FD will be key to enhancing safe driving in the near future. Number 5. Trucks and buses. Trucks and buses utilize long CAN buses, 10 to 20 meters. As a result, they rely on slow bit rates, 250 kilobits per second or 500 kilobits per second as per J1939-14. Here, the upcoming J1939-FD protocol is expected to enable a significant improvement in commercial vehicle features, including, in example, ADAS. Number 6, secure CAN bus. As shown in recent CAN hacker attacks, classical CAN is vulnerable. If hackers gain access to the CAN bus, an example over the air, they could turn off critical functions. CAN-FD authentication via the Secure Onboard Communication, SAC-OC module, may be a key rollout driver. With the rise of CAN-FD, there will also be a rise in use cases for CAN-FD data loggers. In the following, we outline 4 example use cases. As CAN-FD gets rolled out with new cars, CAN-FD data loggers will be key to logging OBD2 data from cars. With CAN-FD being introduced in heavy-duty vehicles, there will be a need for IoT CAN-FD loggers that are compatible with the J1939 flexible data rate protocol. As CAN-OpenFD rolls out, new industrial machinery will need CAN-FD IoT loggers to help predict and avoid breakdowns. Further, a CAN-FD logger can serve as a black box, for example, new prototype vehicles, providing data for diagnostics and R&D. The CAN-Edge is fully compatible with CAN-FD and lets you easily record raw CAN-FD data from any application to an extractable SD card. With the CAN-Edge 2, it is also possible to upload the data to your own server for use in telematics or predictive maintenance. If you'd like to learn more about practical considerations for CAN-FD data logging, see our full CAN-FD intro article. To finish off, let's look briefly at the CAN-FD outlook. In general, CAN-FD is predicted to take over classical CAN in the coming years. For example, the first CAN-FD-capable cars are expected to be sold in 2019 or 2020. The initial rollout will likely use 2 megabits per second and gradually transition to 5 megabits per second. Further, CAN OpenFD has been adapted via CIA 1301 version 1.0 and will likely play an increasing role for industrial automation. Similarly, the new J1939-22 protocol uses CAN FD data frames. Overall, CAN is still a growing technology, but recently, this is mainly due to CAN-FD. It is anticipated that in the future, CAN-FD will be used in most new development projects. For more details, see our CAN-FD intro article on our website, where you'll also find details on our CAN-FD data loggers. If you enjoy these videos, please share, like, or subscribe.